welcome as we slowly begin our virtual worship service today here at the First Presbyterian Church. Happy Easter. Happy Easter. Good morning and welcome to worship here at the First Presbyterian Church of Everett. We are glad that you are here with us this Easter morning. Briefly, just a couple of announcements. First is we will have virtual online worship service again next week at 10 a.m. right here. And we are using the Zoom platform for Monday and Thursday Bible study at 4 o'clock. Today is a day of mystery, grace, and new life. All of us have great traditions on Easter. Maybe you like to wake up early and attend a sunrise service, or hunt around the house for Easter eggs. Maybe we like to have a new spring outfit to wear to worship. We could love the rousing hymns of worship with family and friends on this day. We may have a special meal with extended family later, where we reflect on God's amazing love as Jesus is no longer in the tomb. We know this year is different. This is a unique and challenging time. And this is our fourth virtual Sunday, not having face-to-face worship, and we still have more weeks to go. However, this Easter, the disciples were not out hunting for eggs. The women were not joyfully preparing a meal for their families. The followers of Jesus were not arriving in large number to houses of worship. The disciples were afraid. They were scared, hidden, huddled in their homes, wondering what was going to happen as their teacher and their leader, their Messiah, was dead. The women were preparing to tend to the body of Jesus and did not know who was going to roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb. Followers of Jesus were in a fog. They were filled with grief, pondering what was next, debating on whether to get out of town or to stay. We've seen posts and blogs with smoother words than I have that remind us we, like the first followers, were in their homes, feeling trapped, concerned, not knowing what the future held. We have this day to get a taste what it might have been like on that first Easter. Now, it's hard for every church not being open today. But for those of us who are participating in virtual worship or worship online, all who are watching this morning, this is still a special day. This is a glorious new day, a day where fear does not control us, a day where what we thought was not possible, God made possible. A day where despair does not have the final word. A day where Jesus rose from the dead, proclaiming grace to all. Join with me in our call to worship. The people say, "Blessed be the Lord, who daily bears us up. God is our salvation. Our God is a God of salvation. And to God the Lord belongs escape from death. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter. Blessed be the Lord, who daily bears us up. God is our salvation. Our God is a God of salvation. And to God the Lord belongs escape from death. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
Blessed be the Lord, who daily bears us up.
God is our salvation. Our God is a God of salvation. And to God the Lord belongs escape from death. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
Jesus Christ is the Savior.
us take a brief moment in silence as we begin our prayer this morning. Father, today is a celebration that feels slightly the same. We hear celebrate because of the empty tomb. We are excited to hear the good news that death has lost its sting. We marvel at your love and grace expressed in your Son, Jesus the Christ. Yet this is the experience we can have every Sunday. We honor every day as a chance to receive your gift of life and an opportunity to worship. Every Sunday, in person or online, we claim grace has reached down and redeemed our lives and the lives of all in our world. We praise you for loving us when we are unlovable. We are grateful for carrying us through the valleys of death, and we know you are the good shepherd, and we desire to hear your calm and still voice calling our name. Lord, this is not a day when we hunt for you like an egg. This is not a day when we open a basket hoping for treats of chocolate. You pursue us when we walk away. You find us when we are lost. You open our hearts to love. You have done the heavy lifting, and we are welcomed to your heavenly table where there is enough for all. We praise you, Holy Spirit, for working in our lives. You have connected us even when we are apart. You have sustained us when we have wondered if we could keep going. You have provided for us, surprised us even when we complained about not having enough. You have broken the fear of hoarding. You remind us to share. You cover us with grace and have shown us life is more than busy schedules. Life is full of creative joy, deep beauty, and more. Sometimes all we need to do is slow down. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. Give us strength to follow and mercy as we walk with you one step at a time throughout our lives. Hear us now as we are blessed to pray as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Because he lives.
Try again. Nothing. too serious, so I just tapped my partner's leg to let me go and we would try again. He didn't feel the tap and I started to squirm a little. All right, one more time. Nothing, and I began to worry. When underneath the water, I heard my lifeguard teacher yell, "Let him go!" Now, I may have taken the biggest breath of my entire life when I was released and came to the surface. I was frustrated and I was not pleased. My teacher was yelling, "Why did you not tap to release?" So head to the side, catch your breath. And as I sat there, I kept on replaying the drill in my mind and I began to feel embarrassed. I was the only one who did not complete the task. I was there on the pool, I was there on the side of the pool, and I watched as the class finished and then hit the showers, and my mind began to sort of tell me different stories, and I began to spiral, and I did not want to fail. I was beginning to be afraid. In this brief moment, all these negative thoughts pushed me further and further, worse than the drill had. So I got out of the pool and began to leave, and my instructor said, "Wait." She came over to me, and I prepared to get a stern talking to. Her tone surprised me. She said, "It's okay. Today was just a bad day, you understand?" I nodded. "Good news is we practice again tomorrow. See you then." I'm not going to get dropped from the program? No. I didn't. I had more to learn, and eventually I did complete that certification. I've made plenty of mistakes throughout my life, and I know I will make more. I've disappointed myself and others, and no doubt I will do it again. I don't want to. I want every idea or action or plan to work. I want to pass all the certifications. I want to raise and jump over that bar. I want to be recognized and known for being confident and competent and a great person. But for every idea or task that I feel like I've dropped the ball in the back of my mind, this fear builds up and it chips away at my confidence and my creativity for future endeavors. We've all made mistakes. More will come. We've been disappointed and we've hurt others. We want to be good at everything. We try, especially in those areas we know we can excel at. We are confident one moment and out of our league the next, and this is life. We know it, yet there are places in our lives where we become almost paralyzed by inactivity because of past failures and present fear. We have wanted to take a breath just once before a trial or a test, but we've not been able to do so. We have put our education, our practice into effect only to remain stuck. And at times we've been told to get out of the water, stay in your own lane, keep our nose in our own business, and we begin to ponder our own self-worth. We've come face to face with depression. We've wondered about our confidence. We've been angry at ourselves. We've felt hopeless. And at times we've died a little or have parts of our heart taken away, not by our own doing. And this feels worse than death, but then death comes along reminding us of those deep questions as we stare into the void of the unknown. The disciples, the women, those who had been with Jesus over his ministry, they woke up today. They reviewed in their minds the previous couple of days. They may have been in shock. They might have wondered what to do. Maybe their faith was shattered. They could have been slowly coming to grips with their Messiah, the one that they loved and followed, was dead and buried in a stone tomb. One thing was certain, is Jesus was dead. In the Gospel of Matthew, the two Marys were coming to look at the tomb. They knew the guards were there, and any chance of rolling that stone away seemed futile. When suddenly there was an earthquake, and an angel of the Lord came from heaven, rolled the stone away for a chair, and he had the appearance of lightning. This is so bizarre, the guards went full possum. The women may have been close to this as well. When the angel says, "Bingo, you're right. You passed the test. You figured out the riddle to eternal life. You rose to that challenge. You have paved the way for future generations to work their way into God's favor. Now go tell the others about this and get moving on to your final destination of Galilee where all this will make sense." But we know that's not what the angel said. He shared good news with the women and told them to get the crew together and head to Galilee. But he really didn't do that either. Angel's first words were, "Do not be afraid." Only after they were told, "Do not be afraid," could they hear good news. Even Jesus said, "Do not be afraid." then they could hear good news. We all want good news in life. We want good news to know that we've passed, we've succeeded, we've accomplished, we're right. We've worked hard, we've attained that degree. Good news comes with victories and celebrations and pats on the back. Good news is learning the answer about when we will get back to normal. We hope good news eases pain, covers frustration, and guides us another step. We talk about good news because that's what followers of Jesus talk about. We know good news is supposed to help us and allow us to persevere. Good news is what the Gospels are about and covers everything about Jesus' life. That's good news. Yet I'm a pastor. And even to my ears, good news, just saying those words, can fall flat. We believe Jesus is Lord. We're grateful for God's grace. The Holy Spirit is empowering us to move with agape love. But life can be hard. And just saying good news doesn't always change that. We have questions that don't go away because someone said, hey, good news, it makes it all better. Life happens. There are plenty of times when the water is over our heads and we want a breath. We want to just breathe. We want to know a little bit about this good news that everyone's talking about, but we're just underwater. Maybe this is Easter. We need to hear it in reverse. Do not be afraid. And then good news. Do not be afraid, Mary. What Jesus said took place. See, look where he was buried. Do not be afraid, Mary. See, Jesus is not here. He is alive. Do not be afraid. What was impossible with humanity is possible with God. Do not be afraid. Death does not have the final word. Yes, it may not make sense, but don't overthink, stress, or worry about it. Do not be afraid. Now go tell the others. In verse 8, the women did not run back with a theological epiphany. It didn't make sense. We are told they left quickly with fear and great joy, and they just ran. They might not have even ran in the right direction, but that's okay. You know, death being overcome, Jesus not where he's supposed to be, it's a crazy thing. And suddenly they find Jesus, and they worshiped. They didn't need to think about it. They didn't need a rational answer. They knew it was Jesus, and they worshiped. And Jesus said, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. I'm not leaving. Do not be afraid. I'm with you. Do not be afraid. Go and tell the others this crazy good news that I am alive. This Easter, I pray we all hear good news. We need good news in our lives. Good news of Jesus taking away the sins of the world. Good news of forgiveness. Good news of being justified as humans who are imperfect and cannot do extra credit work to change that. Good news of Jesus rising from the dead as the living proof of God's amazing love for us. All that is good news. Yet do not be afraid. Hear that as well. Do not be afraid is good news. Do not be afraid reminds us that all these crazy things about Easter is good news. Do not be afraid. Our past failures and sin do not define us. That's good news. Do not be afraid. Shame has no power over us. Do not be afraid. God loves us and sent his Son at the right time for us. Do not be afraid. We are not judged, graded, or made worthy by what others think. Do not be afraid. There is justice and mercy, and all things will be redeemed and reconciled by the Holy Spirit. Do not be afraid. We are not alone. Do not be afraid. Jesus is alive. Do not be afraid. The tomb is empty. Hear it. Jesus is alive. Do not be afraid. He is risen. Tell others. Do not be afraid. He is risen. Do not be afraid. He is risen indeed. Do not be afraid. This is good news. Amen.
Amen.
Spirit of
Christ arose, and Jesus Christ, the Lord, is risen today.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah.